Good morning. Welcome to Up to the Minute. I'm Todd Duplantis. Good to have you with us on the show. We've got your HCC news and information, some special guests coming up, and it's Thursday Family Fun Day. More on that in a few moments. My co-host this morning, joining me from her home, Stacey Hawkins, our own HCCTV producer of the topic, and she's also a communications professor here at HCC. Good to see you, Stacey.
Great to be here. Now, folks, we're live on Houston Community College District's Facebook page and on YouTube. Now, when you go to Facebook or YouTube and you've got that little search area, type in Houston Community College District because there's a lot of things abbreviated HCC. Now, we're also on Twitter, LinkedIn, and Instagram. And if you want to go old school cable or satellite, you can see us on HCCTV at noon, 5 and 10 p.m. Monday through Friday.
That's right. Okay, Stacey, I know that you're a bit of a history buff, aren't you?
Absolutely.
All right. So Stacey is going to enjoy this next interview. Jonathan Huhn is the Director of Communications and Community Outreach with the Alamo Trust Incorporated. Jonathan, good to see you on the show. Thanks for being here.
Good morning. My pleasure.
You guys have a number of big things coming up. You've got new things you've opened at the Alamo and a very special birthday as well, right?
That's right. Davy Crockett's birthday, 236 years young.
Wow. We're going to hear all about that shortly. So stick around, Jonathan. We'll be with you soon. Okay. We're going to kick things off. We've got the program coordinator at HCC Speech Department. James Duvall is joining us. James, good to see you here with us. Let's see if we can get you to, there we go.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, let's start off first off, and maybe you can tell us what exactly is speech communications and how it is present in our everyday lives.
Yeah, sure. When it comes to speech communications, we do everything from courses from intro to communications all the way up to business professional communications, and also in between public speaking and interpersonal, which deals with relationships. It's present in our everyday lives because of what we're doing right now.
Right.
We're walking down the street, at our jobs, in the classroom, in our home, and we're always and constantly communicating with one another one way or another, even when we're not intended to trying to communicate with somebody else. So we are always saying something to somebody, whether we realize it or not.
What are some of the fundamental classes that you can take for speech communications? I know there's 1311 and 1315. Maybe you can tell us a bit about those two courses.
Sure. 1311, Intro to Communications, mainly deals with the very basics of communication, starting from the times of Aristotle, Plato, and Socrates. And then we go all the way up to talking about mass comm and the very basics of public speaking as well, and the very basics of business professional communication. I always like the business and professional communication part because I get to give students real life situations that companies had to deal with and employees had to deal with. And they get to get a sort of their first taste of what it means to have complications or troubles in a company. For public speaking, it mainly deals with being a good speaker, in terms of ethics, in terms of logic, and in terms of passion as well. And so it's all about speaking and speaking well in front of audiences in any context that they are in.
In public speaking, how important, you know, if you're, so let's say you're going into math or science, how important is it to take one of these courses as a basic just to be well-rounded with your college education?
If you can take something very complicated and have everybody understand it, be it math or in the science area, that is a very big deal because in any subject, and especially in math or in sciences, there are some very complicated topics, and being able to have people understand them and where they can comprehend it and use it as well is a very big deal. And that takes technique, it takes development to be able to deliver that kind of speech with something that complicated.
The students get in there and learn more about themselves and new skills, not just how to communicate, but what are some of the things these students are going to learn about themselves?
Oh, definitely. They realize that they have a voice, that they can talk about things. And one of the big things I've noticed with students is to be able to allay the fears that everybody has. I have it myself, and I admit that to my students. And I don't mind that because it lets them know everybody has this anxiety to speak in front of people.
Yeah.
And they learn how to manage it and they come out better speakers. And one of my favorites, having more self-confidence.
Well, that's one thing too, because I imagine as the course transpires through the semester, you may have a timid student who finally finds their voice. And as they develop that self-confidence, they're able to present themselves in a totally different way. Do you see that metamorphosis as the semester goes by with some students?
Absolutely. In fact, I've had plenty of students who almost faint in the very beginning of the semester when they're doing their very first speech. And then I just see this development where they get better and better and better. And then you could see their happiness in their face, being able to do it in front of people without passing out, without shaking, and to have much more confidence in the way they speak.
And talk about how you can prepare the students for the workplace. You kind of touched on that earlier, but you can't emphasize how important it is to take these type of courses so that you can communicate in the workplace as you move forward with your career.
Communications is a big deal. And when it comes to the workplace environment, they want people to be able to talk and listen to other people because everybody forgets we have to listen to each other in the workplace. And sometimes that can be hard. I will admit that has happened, but it's one of the things I always emphasize: listen and be able to talk to everybody in a way where everyone understands. And more importantly, being able to resolve conflicts that happen in the workplace, because that just happens as well. And that's one of the ways we try to prepare students when they transition to the workplace.
These courses, I know we mentioned 1311, 1315, but there's also 1318 and 1321, interpersonal communication, relationships, and business communication and professional communication. These are courses, obviously, that transfer to other colleges if a student's looking to continue on their career. Is it better to get these under your belt while you're at HCC if you're looking to maybe expand and go to maybe UT or somewhere else after your 2 years at HCC?
I would always advocate for both because people don't realize how much relationships matter in every single context you're in. And not just that, but a relationship that you have with yourself, the intrapersonal aspect and how you think about yourself, which also means your self-image, self-esteem, and self-confidence. And so we do a very deep dive about the relationships and theories that come along with it when it comes to 1318 interpersonal communication. And 1321, this is actually also a deep dive with theories in the business context as well, because I always like to give scenarios, one of my favorite scenarios, and I always like to use the Bluebell scenario that students don't know about. And I would say, well, this is the problem. What is the plan of action and how do we fix this?
Right. James Duvall, he is the program coordinator for HCC Speech Department. As you know, folks, registration is underway right now. If you want to get into the fall semester, he's registering there. They've got classes starting on Monday. Make sure you do so. Big drive this weekend on our campuses for registration. We'll talk more about that later in the show. James, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Okay, Stacy. History buff, I know you're going to enjoy this next segment. You've got, we're going to be talking about the Alamo, taking us out to San Antonio.
Yes, we've got Jonathan Huhn with us. He's the Director of Communications and Community Outreach for the Alamo Trust Incorporated. Thank you so much for joining us, Jonathan.
Stacey, it's my pleasure for being here.
Now, most of us in Texas, when we think about Davy Crockett, we think about him as the iconic Alamo Defender. But yes. I am old enough that when I was a child on Sunday nights, I watched The Wonderful World of Disney, and they had this show called Davy Crockett, King of the Wild Frontier. So he had this whole life before the Alamo. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, well, that's a great question, because Davy Crockett was actually born in Eastern Tennessee in August 17, 1786. He was the fifth of nine brothers and sisters. His father taught him how to shoot and trap, but most importantly, provided a very monumental influence on his life because his father was actually a veteran of the American Revolutionary War. He grew up on the American frontier, did odd jobs like working in his family's tavern, running cattle across state lines, worked on both his family farm and farms within the community. And really interesting from a school aspect, he actually didn't join school until he was about 13 years old, but that only lasted about a handful of days because he got into a fight with a school bully and, fearing reprisal from his father, actually ran away from home for a few years. And during that time, he was living on his own, going town to town, also living in the Tennessee countryside, trapping animals and doing odd jobs to survive. It wasn't until a few years later, when he was nearly 16, they actually returned home and his family barely recognized him.
He sounds kind of like the Renaissance man of the frontier.
Oh, yes. More importantly, a lot of people don't know that he was a three-term congressman prior to actually coming out to the Alamo. Before that, he was in the Tennessee State Assembly and then also served in the Tennessee Militia as enlisting in the 2nd Regiment of the Volunteer Mounted Riflemen.
Now, you mentioned that he's got a birthday coming up.
That's correct. Here at the Alamo, we've actually been celebrating his birthday for about 10 to 15 years now. But this Saturday from 9 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. on the grounds of the Alamo, we're having a wonderful celebration to honor Mr. Crockett and help to provide an 1830s taste of life for our visitors. As we were discussing before we started our interview, we have the new wonderful Palisade exhibit. It's a wooden fortification of the southeast corner of the Alamo. Just came online December of 2021. And it'll be a location where historians will be able to recreate Davy Crockett, share a lot of the tales of his life. There will be a rifle firing demonstration, displays on how people of the time made clothing, leatherwork, corn husk dolls. There'll also be games, rubber band shooting for the kids, as well as a young Texan tour.
Now, my husband and I spent a couple of years in San Antonio when we first got married, and we go back there a lot. And it's really interesting to go to the Alamo and see it just kind of surrounded by all these modern buildings. It's a little bit hard sometimes to think about it in context in what it would have looked like before. You think of the Alamo as that one building, but the Alamo was more than just that one building, right?
Absolutely. The full Alamo compound was much larger than just the church and Long Barrack that you see today. And one of the things that we're actually working on through the Alamo plan is a new application, really trying to bring the Alamo to the 21st century with the Alamo plan. And in this application, we'll have augmented reality in different points and periods of time where you can hold up your iPhone or Android device, look around the actual grounds and see what it looked like at that time and location in which you select on the app.
Now, I'm going to throw kind of a different question at you here. If people are out there and they're listening to this and they're like, this is so incredibly exciting, the work you do is so great, how can the public kind of support the mission of the Alamo?
It's a great question. So if you go to our website, thealamo.org, you can see all the information about the Alamo plan and potentially support our foundation called RTAF, the Remember the Alamo Foundation, as we're continuing to fundraise and get support for the Alamo plan as we're trying to bring online some of our newest buildings, because at the end of this year, we'll have the new Exhibition Hall and Collections building going online, again, the newest building since the 1950s that will help us enhance and increase our museum-grade exhibition space, because right now we can only put about 1% of the total items we have on display. That includes things like two swords we have from Santa Ana that are in our vault. And we're wanting to make certain and have that exhibition space to connect these items with the public, which we simply can't do without the space.
How can people keep up with what's going on at the Alamo between their visits to San Antonio?
Excellent question. Again, our website, thealamo.org, would be a wonderful place. And also signing up for our monthly newsletter would be very important to keep up with key updates that are taking place on the plant.
Jonathan Huhn, thank you so much for being with us and for telling us about what's going on at the Alamo and the Alamo Trust Incorporated.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Hey, Jonathan, before you go, I got a question for you. So yes. I know you've got a lot of cool stuff out there at the Alamo, a lot on exhibit. What is your favorite piece that you are just amazed by out of the collection? Can you think of one or two?
There is a leather shield from the Mexican Army that there are very few in existence because the leather just doesn't last over time. Yeah. That's a very unique item in our collection. But we do have, as I mentioned, two swords from Santa Ana and one of his rifles. And those are probably my favorite two items that are within the Alamo collection currently.
You know, between fact and fiction, there's a lot of movies that were made about the Alamo. In reality, when you see the Hollywood version, and even with Stacy talking about, you know, the Davy Crockett thing and the Wonderful World of Disney, maybe 1% of that was true. Well, it was a good show. It really was a good show. What are some of the things as far as what Hollywood's portrayed as versus reality that kind of sticks out to you?
You know, one interesting story that I'm kind of surprised you actually don't hear about, which I think should have gotten a little more pop culture coverage, was that Mr. Crockett, who was Representative Crockett at the time in early 1835, helped to thwart was the first presidential assassination attempts on Andrew Jackson. Jackson was exiting the U.S. Capitol, and there was an individual, I believe by the name of Richard Lawrence, that had two pistols. Both misfired, surprisingly, and Representative Crockett, along with a Navy lieutenant, helped to actually tackle and subdue this individual. And it's something you haven't really seen talked about in any of the pop culture references from Fess Parker in the 1950s, John Wayne in the 1960s, and then even Billy Bob Thornton in 2004. Yeah. So sometimes some of his legend is so vast and wide that it's not even covered. So I think that's an excellent representation where they focus on more of the Alamo, but less his early upbringing.
Yeah, because his life before reaching the Alamo, as Stacy mentioned, it was fascinating, you know, from being a congressman to, you know, winding up at the Alamo. I don't think he certainly didn't want to make his last stand there. I think it was just another part of his journey that he was heading on. Jonathan, we thank you for being here with us again and continued success there at the Alamo. I'm going to get out there in the next couple of months. All right.
Please let me know when you're here. Happy to give you a personal tour.
We'd love to see you. All right. Thanks, Jonathan. Thanks for being here this morning.
Thank you.
All right, Stacy. And Stacy, you also have recommendations for restaurants in San Antonio as well?
Absolutely. There is a wonderful seafood restaurant called Ernesto's.
Okay.
There's true Mexican style seafood.
Yeah.
The chef is fantastic. Just put yourself in his hands and say, bring me what you've got on special. Bring me what's freshest today, and he'll hook you up.
All right. Got to get out there to San Antonio. A lot going on. Okay. A lot going on here at HCC. You know, we've got registration going on this week, and you want to get registered for the spring. We'll talk more about that, or for the spring. No, let's try fall 2022. We're headed in there right now, so we'll have more on that in a second. This weekend, there are registration fairs that are happening across the district. What does that mean? Well, it means you can actually go to a campus and register in person, meet with people face-to-face. It's usually very busy on campuses on this weekend because classes start on Monday, so keep that in mind. So pack a little patience, but you can get everything taken care of ahead of time before going into the fall semester. And there's a chance to win $500. There's raffles going on across the district. You can get personalized enrollment support services from the staff on the campuses. That's 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Saturday, August the 20th, this coming Saturday. We'll have a link with more information in the post after the show. And tomorrow's a big day, too, because a bunch of us, including you, Stacy, are going to be busy with convocation.
Absolutely. Every year, we get together for a convocation, the faculty and staff of HCC, to kind of set our vision for the next year. This year's theme is harnessing our entrepreneurial capacity. Now, what that means for you and our audience that are not faculty and staff at HCC is that Up to the Minute will not air tomorrow, but we'll be back on Monday to kick off the fall semester.
That's right. We will return on Monday. A very popular thing here at HCC, you know, Mattress Mac, of course, Gallery Furniture's Mattress Mac. He's a local legend. Well, he has a school of selling here at HCC. HCC's Northwest Mattress Mac School of Selling is now collaborating with Work Texas to offer an expanded on-site program that includes Jim McInvale's successful customer service training. This is a phenomenal course if you're interested in sales. I mean, it fills up very quickly. It's very popular. It's happening 6 to 10 p.m. Mondays through Thursdays through September 27th at Gallery Furniture. So you can go out to Gallery Furniture. If you haven't been there, it's like a furniture store and a bazaar all in once. It's pretty cool. So make sure you check that out. We'll have some information on how you can register for the School of Selling in our social media post after the show. Get ready for prom night. Betacek Orman auction is upcoming. Stacy.
You know, in high school, I never went to my prom, and now I have a chance. I'm going to.
Now's your chance.
Now's my chance. I'm going to get a big chiffon dress that's going to make me, you know, look like some big tropical plant. I'm marking.
And you can stay out all night too.
Oh, that's absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. On Friday, October 28th at our beautiful West Houston Institute, the Betacek Orman Auction Gala, it's going to support professional development opportunities for HCC faculty. Make plans now to enjoy an evening bidding on some fantastic items for a great cause. And we'll have that link in our post after the show.
You know, it's amazing because they actually have some famous artwork that may pop up that people donate. There's some cool stuff they auction every year. So make sure you check it out. Maybe you can get a trip that you can bid on, that you can get that out of the auction. And all the money goes to a great cause of benefiting our faculty in Richmond. Okay. Transcending Borders Faculty Exhibition is ongoing through November 4th at HCC's Southeast College Eastside Learning Hub Gallery. It's the works of Sandra De La Rosa. It's called Transcending Borders, and it's being featured all throughout through November the 4th at that location. If you want to check it out, you don't have to register ahead of time. You can just go check it out. We'll tell you where and have more information in the post after our show. Okay, fall registration. It gets classes start on Monday. You don't want to wait till Monday, though, Stacy, because I know you're one of our adjuncts, and it's important to like sign up for your class and all of them ahead of time.
Absolutely. I'm teaching 1335, COM 1335, Introduction to Electronic Media. There's still a few seats left in the class. My class is what they call online anytime. That means that there's no established class meeting. You can also take classes that are online on a schedule. That means that you can take them from home or Starbucks or wherever, but you have to sign on at a certain time. We've got some hybrid classes where you have partial face-to-face and partial virtually. We have in-person classes that are your traditional face-to-face, and we also have some hybrid lab courses where you have some studio or laboratory time. For all of these classes in all of our programs, you can go to hccs.edu/apply.
Right. Register now. You still have time to do so before the classes start on Monday. Okay. Next week on the show, we've got Ravi Brombot, HCC's pitch competition. He'll be joining us to tell us about all their big fall plans. And Mental Health Monday, that happens on Monday as well. Plus, we have Tasty Tuesday, and we're going to be joined by Houston's own Serenity Knives. Huh, that should be interesting. They'll be here to talk with about their local bladesmith, how they can create Japanese and German competition chef knives. That's interesting. I would be interested in buying one of those. So we should get them on. That'll be interesting. That's coming up on Tuesday, on Tasty Tuesday. No show tomorrow. We're going to be doing Convocation, but Up to the Minute returns on Monday. Stacy, thanks for being here.
Thank you. I enjoyed it. I loved having a chance to talk about San Antonio.
That's right. That's right. Once again, if you want to learn more about the Alamo or any of the subjects that we cover, make sure you check our social media posts after the show. All right, folks, have a great weekend. I'm Todd Duplantis. We'll see you next week.